ha 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 ba da ba da 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 ba da ba da ba da. Hi everyone, it's the best teeth in the game here, and it's time for another edition of Let's Argue, where I let you guys throw at me on the internet all sorts of hot takes and popular opinions and tough questions. I answer the best ones in video segments such as these. Let's go! Cardi B is showing herself to be nothing but a fad artist, with her music being incredibly bland, weak, her vocals being incredibly obnoxious, and overall shit, we've heard already. Her fame will fade within a year or two, and she will be forgotten like the next Iggy Azalea. Well, I mean, I feel like Iggy Azalea faded because she had too many moments where she just put her own foot in her mouth, whereas Cardi B has not experienced that up until this point. I feel like with Iggy Azalea, it wasn't so much the music trailing off as much as just her public persona. I guess as long as Cardi B continues to get along in the mainstream and appeal to the fans who stan her, she's probably not going anywhere anytime soon. However, is that to say I'm gonna bet right now $10,000 that she's going to evolve and grow and become more complex as an artist as the years draw on? I'm not gonna hold my breath on that. However, I don't think Cardi B is just going to disappear in the next few years. We may have reached a point of saturation for Cardi B's popularity at this point right now, yes, but the industry would be stupid not to at least try to come out with three or four more albums with her. Like, they're probably gonna come out in the black, just based off of the success that she's had so far. It would be like not coming out with another fucking Avatar movie after all the money that James Cameron made off that shit. Australian rap is miles above anything produced in America and the UK. All right, dude. Let's hear that To Pimp a Kangaroo then. People sleep on video game music like it's some big other section of sound, yet I feel like some of the most compelling moving tracks of the decade have come out of the medium. Examples, so on and so forth, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, I mean, I agree to an extent. I'm not really huge on soundtrack music, but I can certainly say that some of my favorite little melodic ditties over the course of my lifetime have come from video games, especially during my childhood. I look very fondly and nostalgically back onto the video game soundtracks of Super Mario Brothers and Donkey Kong Country and Mega Man, just all the friggin' Mega Man games. All those levels had fire songs. Metroid, Zelda, Link to the Past, and I love some new ones as well. The Minecraft soundtrack is excellent in my opinion, as well as the Cuphead soundtrack. So there are a lot of good video game soundtracks out there. Hell yeah. This guy has a picture that says the current state of hip hop, and it's a YouTube screenshot under, I guess, some kind of hip hop recommendation algorithm. Looks like it features a guy playing a video game, and it says Gucci Gang, Gucci Gang, Gucci Gang. Then Cardi B performing Bodak Yellow live in Washington. Rice Gum, It's Every Night, Sis. And then lo-fi hip-hop radio beats to relax and study to with 7,000 viewers. Yeah, the genre's fucked. Music criticism has gradually become more focused on celebrating well-crafted, accessible pop songs than experimentation. I'm not 100% sure if I would say that this is something that music criticism has progressed toward, as much as it's been kind of a prevailing trend of sorts in a way. Certainly you have pockets during the raucous 60s and 70s and 80s, as well as the early days of Pitchfork, where I think the picks of what was great and what was not so great were a little bit more interesting, edgy, cutting edge. But I mean, look at Rolling Stone's top albums of all time. Not exactly the most experimental albums ever, but I do wholeheartedly agree with what you're getting at in this tweet over here, because I feel like with the embrace, the very recent embrace of poptimism in the mainstream and the underground, there has kind of been a lack of appreciation of not just experimentation, but just other genres of music that aren't so quite pop-centric. And I myself have fallen prey to this as well with the things I choose to cover. And honestly, I'm not as upset about it as maybe I should be, given that I've come to enjoy a lot of mainstream and very popular music quite a bit, whereas when I was in high school and college, I was quite bitter and hateful toward it. I've mellowed out on that front. I think it's mostly for the better. But still, I can't help but feel like at the end of the day, I'm not covering quite as much experimental or just just off the beaten path music as I potentially could be, and I apologize for that. I'm always trying to do better, I guess. People discrediting Father John Misty as pretentious are 100% wrong. A lot of his material involves him being hyper aware of how preachy he is, and digging deeper into his lyrics actually does show some complex and interesting ideas you don't find by simply glancing at genius. That is absolutely true. Like, Father John Misty is way more self-aware than I think a lot of people give him credit for, and I don't know why. The dude is clearly aware of the words coming out of his mouth, what they mean, how most people will most likely take them, and he toys with the idea of ego in his music in a very knowing way. So how you could write him off as just being 100% genuinely egotistical and pretentious is just kind of beyond me. Sure, is there maybe a note or a kernel of that to his true personality? Possibly. I mean, if it wasn't there, I don't think he'd be able to inflate it to the degree that he has and know pretentiousness and know the ego so well. However, I give him all the credit in the world for engaging in these things creatively. The Mac DeMarco knockoff bands are the indie equivalent to SoundCloud rappers. That's too true. Too true. A truer word has never been spoken. I love J Dilla, but I don't believe he would want people listening to all the rough cuts and old beats that have been coming out for the past few years. Considering how much of a perfectionist he was, he would have preferred to be remembered for a smaller, flawless body of work. Most likely, yes, but I feel like more of his stuff coming out doesn't necessarily change our image of J Dilla, because we understand that this stuff is rough, we understand that it's posthumous, we understand that it's not 100% finished. I'm a little on the fence with this issue, because while in one breath I feel like it's kind of unfair to essentially just, you know, kind of grave rob a musician's leftover vault and just be like, we should hear all of this, we deserve to hear all of this, it's a little greedy, it's a little presumptuous. However, from what I understand, J Dilla's music sales and releases go to his family, help his family, and I feel like at the end of the day, he would want his music to do that. Assuming he's of the utilitarian sort, he might have just seen the net positive in releasing music and it helping the people who he loved, whether it was 100% finished or not. Do I think grunge could ever make a comeback, or is it forever going to be a timestamp genre? I mean, I thought it had like a little bit of a comeback in the indie scene over like the past couple of years, but the interest sort of fell off. I feel like the little like hump of a grunge revival that happened in the underground is either dead or kind of dying. Talking Heads is literally autism music. Which, I mean, I would take gross offense to this and shut this person down, but I've been reading David Byrne's How Music Works book, and he routinely makes autism jokes at the expense of himself and his live performances and the Talking Heads music. So I feel like there's pretty much a grain of truth to this. You're a fool for not reviewing Dex Meets Dexter. Pick it up, it deserves a decent to solid 10 at least. He beats women and his music is trash. Imagine Dragons is far worse than Nickelback. Nickelback at least had some decently catchy rock songs, while Imagine Dragons creates flat and terrible pop music, and I will add on to this, with the same explosive, boring, formulaic choruses laced into nearly every track. Yes, I absolutely agree. Imagine Dragons is worse than Nickelback. Nickelback has way better songs than Imagine Dragons, or at least I don't get the sense that they're writing the same song again and again and again. And on top of that, well, Nickelback, when I was a kid, I thought they sucked. They were awful. They weren't the worst band, though, especially with hindsight being 2020 now. You know who was the worst band? Godsmack. They sucked, and they suck. Godsmack sucks. Slow, boring, drawling songs, a singer whose voice just sounds like a drunk Eddie Vedder, moaning and maybe even growling over every single track. Awful band name, awful logo, wouldn't even exist if not for Alice in Chains. And they're about to come out with a new album too, which I'm sure is gonna be their greatest album yet. And I'm going to leave it at that. Thank you everyone for watching another installment of Let's Argue. Over here next to my head is a playlist where you can watch more videos in the series. Hit that up or the link to subscribe to the channel. I love you, love you, love you, love you, love ya. Anthony Fantano, Let's Argue forever.